Awesome. Thanks so much, Glenn. All right. So. Here we go. Hello, I'm Harriet. As Glenn said, I'm from Melbourne, Australia. And today I'm going to be talking about community building with the help of sociolinguistics. So this talks about what sociolinguistics is, how it's relevant to us in the JavaScript community, and how each of us can use tactics from there in our day-to-day communications to help make the JavaScript community more welcoming to everyone, and a really nice thing to be a part of. So before we get too deep into that, a little bit about me. I work at BuildKite as a technical writer. We're a continuous integration platform, so our product is mostly used by other developers. So I spend a lot of time thinking about how best to explain parts of our product to technical users who may or may not be familiar with continuous integration. I also worked as a front-end developer for about 5 years before I realized that I was actually way more interested in writing documentation and helping other developers use cool tools than I was in writing code. So this realization kicked off my master's degree, and now I'm most of the way through a Master's of Applied Linguistics at the University of Melbourne. It was during this degree that I got interested in the intersection of linguistics and computer science. And from there, I started looking at language communities and how they're built. So this talk started life as a paper for uni, this paper, in fact, and it gave me an opportunity to compare a tutorial that introduced JavaScript from 10 years ago to one from 2013. It turns out that I can't actually squish 4,000 or 5,000 words into a 25-minute talk, but I've tried my best, and you're welcome to come find me afterwards if you have any questions. So let's talk about communities. What is a community? Pretty much just a bunch of people all together doing the same thing. And in linguistics, we call this a community of practice. It's a place where we do shared meaning making. And usually, this term is used for communities that are formed around a specific goal, so like a project or an open source tool. But we can take this further, and we can look at communities that form around programming languages. They're communities of practice, just like the ones that form around natural languages. We need to keep in mind what our community looks like from the outside, as well as from the inside, because this is what we look like to potential new members. So when a new person wants to join a community, they have to learn the things that we do differently to their existing communities. So all of us here are part of the JavaScript community, and likely you're part of a lot of other ones as well. Have a think about the general feeling that you get from people on the internet talking about using JavaScript versus talking about using Ruby versus talking about using Golang. It's all slightly different. Now, all these things that we do differently can be roughly divided into two categories. We've got language and culture. So the language things, that's like jargon and like community-wide in-jokes and that kind of stuff. And the cultural things, that's our approach to open source, our diversity strategy, how we go about solving problems. Problems with communication as well as programming problems. So language can also be described as linguistics factors, and cultural ones can be considered social factors. So if we mush these two together, we get sociolinguistics. So we've got some definitions. Sociolinguistics, study of how language functions in a society. This is a really broad field. It covers way too much stuff for this talk. So something more relevant to us is language socialization. This is how becoming a member of a society through the use of language. So I said this talk would be about sociolinguistics. I lied. It's about socialization. But that doesn't sound anywhere near as exciting. So in the natural language learning sense, socialization is all of the words that we use and all of the other stuff that is not words as well. You might already be familiar with this concept. Have you ever found that it's easier to learn a language if you're living in a country that speaks it? You get all the pronunciation, the slang, the body language, and other important junk all at the same time. And all of this together is socialization. So being part of a community means that you're helping to build it. And we want nice communities. We want people to feel welcome, and we want it to be easy for them to join. And these things are really important because we want more people to come and be part of the JavaScript magic. So let's have a look at how we can do this better. So JavaScript people are actually already pretty great at this stuff compared to a lot of other tech communities. But what does socialization look like in practice? So the most important thing for us is the language that we use when we talk about JavaScript. So there are different programming languages. We have different ways of being a member. So how do we let people know what our special JavaScript way of doing things actually is? We use socialization strategies. And there's heaps of them, and I'm not going to cover all of them today. I've picked out some of them, and I've divided them up into three categories to make them easier for us to use. So to start with, we've got welcoming, learner-focused, and community-focused strategies. So there are two types of welcoming, positive and negative. So an example of some positive welcoming is a tweet something like this. So here's my tiny project. Learning this thing was hard, but was also fun and worth it. So let's break this down into sections. Here's some of my tiny project. This little bit actually tells us quite a lot about our community of practice. It tells us that posting a very small project or a fragment of one is totally normal, and that things don't have to be huge, brilliant ideas, and they don't need to be finished or perfect for us to share them. Learning this thing was hard. This shows people who are reading the tweet that JavaScript developers are comfortable with vulnerability, and it makes vulnerability okay for others as well. It was also fun and worth it. So this shows that there's a payoff for all this work that you're putting in, and that you don't have to finish things for them to be worthwhile sharing. So these three things together, when viewed from outside the JavaScript community, welcome people in a positive fashion. Seeing tweets like this fosters goodwill towards our community, and could even spark people's interest in learning JavaScript. So seeing tweets like this is great for users who are new to JavaScript, but it's also nice for people who are already members. It helps everyone feel more comfortable about using JavaScript and being associated with our community. Just as a side note, it's often not possible for people in minority groups to post things like this. They can be seen as less capable and less experienced, even if they're an expert, and it's potentially damaging to their job opportunities. So for those of you who are in positions of privilege, please use that privilege, oh, so many P's, to make this communication style the norm. So next up, we've got negative welcoming. So I've made this pull request. How about this for the footer? My friend has commented on it. Lol, so gross. So this might be an in-joke. We both know it's sarcasm. But for anyone not in our exclusive little sarcasm club, this looks really mean. But it's obviously a joke, right? No, it's not, actually. It makes us look like when someone makes a pull request, we're going to attack the quality of their contributor's work, make light of their efforts, and could be alienating for existing team members as well as for newcomers. Could even entirely scare off potential external contributors. So negative welcoming like this and other types of hazing confronts new members with their shortcomings. So imagine seeing this when you've only just started using JavaScript and you thought this PR looked great. You're likely to think, if this is what they're saying about this code, what are they going to say about mine? And that's pretty discouraging. So next up, we've got learner-focused strategies. I'm going to start off with legitimation. This is telling learners and members that the things that they have been working on are legitimate. So be encouraging to people working in JavaScript or on a particular project. It's kind of like positive reinforcement. So it's hard to be in the JavaScript community if no one recognizes the work that you're doing as an appropriate use of JavaScript. For example, a colleague posts this pull request, updates for the new sign-in page. And I've commented, cool, merged, thumbs up. At first glance, this is friendly and supportive. But what if we took this a step further with something more like this? Nice use of props. You're really getting the hang of React. Merged, thumbs up. This isn't much longer, but it conveys the same message as the previous comment. But importantly, it makes it so clear to the author of the pull request that the work they've done is a good use of the language that they're working in. You can also use this strategy if someone has tried a new approach to a problem that didn't work out, or a pull request that isn't going to be merged. These scenarios should not delegitimize the work that was done. So we can make sure that the authors still feel positive about working with JavaScript, just by changing how we talk about it. So this leads into our next strategy, normalizing failure. So failing to complete a task shouldn't reflect on you personally or your coding ability. We all know that writing JavaScript is hard, and we're not perfect all the time. We need to also make sure that our juniors and people outside our community know this as well as our existing members. For example, I've personally been trying to stop using the words easy and simple in documentation that I write. So say we have some setup instructions. So my setup instructions for my super rad project. Get set up with our short and easy instructions. Simply spin up a Docker container, run tests, run build, party. So we've got both the words easy and simple here. And these instructions are fine if you know how to do all the steps and they run smoothly. but if you don't know how to use Docker, or if anything goes wrong, we've already undercut our users' confidence by telling them that they should be finding this easy. By adding a few extra bits to these instructions, we can make people more comfortable with not succeeding on their first shot. So let's add some more to that introduction. So the steps below will help you set up SuperRad Project. If you run into any trouble, check out our FAQs or ask a question in Slack. So we've removed the word easy, which is a great start. And by mentioning that you may need help, we're immediately normalizing the possibility of failing to set this up. So we can make our list of instructions better too. Spin up a Docker container. Run tests with Mocha. Build the code with npm run build. Party. So by removing the word simply from the first step, we've changed the expectations about how difficult this task is going to be. And by adding links to more information, we've removed the frankly unreasonable assumption that you already know what you're doing and you're not going to need to look anything up. So these two learner-focused strategies, legitimation and normalizing failure, work together really well to make it easier for all of us to persevere when we're faced with problems that we don't know how to solve. Next up, we've got self-efficacy. This is about supporting people's belief in their own ability to succeed. A study was conducted in 2012 into first-year university students' perceptions of their own coding abilities when they were learning how to program. The TLDR of this study is, if they didn't believe in their own ability to succeed and to successfully write code, even if they made a lot of mistakes along the way, both their performance and their mental well-being decreased dramatically. One of the major takeaways from the study was that if students have much higher ratio of successes to failures when they're first learning, they're much more likely to develop resilience and positive self-efficacy. So we can take that suggestion and apply it to our community. So when people are learning JavaScript, help them have a good time with it. If your project or team has new contributors, start tagging all your tasks, even if you know it's something that you'll personally be working on. So lots of projects use tags on their issues. They usually look something like these. Here we've got an issue, update team photos to use new module. With three tags, front end, new contributor, and get started. And these tags are great, and they flag things clearly as being appropriate for people who are starting out. But I think we can do one better. What if we were tagging with more useful and less junior-oriented language like these? React only, self-contained, and documented. So these provide even more information for us. They're also not specifically targeting people who haven't previously contributed to this project. Juniors will still be able to identify this as a task that they're capable of, and it provides all of the pertinent knowledge straight up, rather than having to wade through an issue description. It tells you that it's only React, so that you know you won't suddenly find yourself wading through a C library. And adding that it's documented lets contributors know that if they're having a hard time, there's easily accessible help available. So having put a bit of extra work into these tags, this issue already feels much less like a busy work junior task, which, to be quite honest, I hated being assigned when I was a junior, and like the legitimate, useful work that it is. It's also much more appealing for developers at other stages of their career. As a senior developer, you don't always want to be re-architecting parts of your product, or untangling spaghetti code, or shaving yaks while solving complex bugs. Sometimes you need smaller tasks that are well documented. So the last learner-focused strategy that I'm going to talk about today is legitimate peripheral participation. And this one I'm particularly passionate about, so it gets rockets. So this is about ways that you can participate in the JavaScript community that aren't writing code, but are still important parts of being a member. Things like upvoting Stack Overflow questions and answers, or asking and answering them yourself. Writing blogs and Medium articles. Tweeting about new things that you've done or challenges that you're facing. Making these activities just as important as writing code makes our community easier to join. And it's easier to be a part of for existing members. While writing code is a core part of our community, having other activities be equally important is way more fun and provides us all with legitimate ways to engage when we can't or don't want to be writing code. So finally, we've got our community-focused strategies. The first one I'll talk about is active participation. So this is about encouraging people to do communication well And we don't get awesome communities without people interacting with each other. So even though this is called active participation, it covers activities like reading blog posts or looking at things on Stack Overflow, as well as obviously active things like talking to other developers and attending meetups. So everyone here has already taken a great step for this one by attending this conference. And now you can all take it a step further. So tell the people that you meet what you're working on, even if you don't think it's particularly exciting. Or if you're willing to really commit to improving your community, tell people what you're struggling with. You might find yourself talking to someone who has had that exact same niche webpack config bug and can tell you how to fix it. So next up, we've got strategies for getting help. This is about defining how people can find help relating to your project. This applies to internal projects as well as open source ones. So rather than just listing the names of the maintainers in your README or on your projects page and assuming that people will know that they can get in touch with you, have a go at figuring out and writing down some ways that users or team members can get help. So we want to define as much as we can so that people are comfortable trying to help themselves. And if that doesn't work, then they're also comfortable asking other people for help. And this can be scary. It's a bit like calling up to book your own doctor's appointment, and talking to people on the phone is generally not a good time, but it is vastly improved if you know what you should say and when you need to say it. In the same way, asking for help with JavaScript can be much less difficult if you know that there are steps that you can follow. So let's add some more to this README. We could add sections for debugging. So maybe different parts of your project have different debugging strategies, like installation versus running tests. You could add an FAQ. If you have community support, like Slack groups or local meetups. And tell them where to ask questions. So other places that people can go to ask questions if they can't sort it out for themselves. So where to ask questions is really a whole point of its own. And it leads me to my final community-focused strategy, support structures. Now, these are really vital. There are so many different places that you can get help in the JavaScript community. There are thousands of online tutorials, there are meetups, it's Twitter, it's conferences, GitHub issues, Slack groups, and so many more. But we need to let people know where to go, and that it's okay to do so. So JavaScript already does this pretty well. We encourage people to talk about things that have gone badly, as well as ones that have worked. But we can set an even better example for our newcomers by posting about things we've learned at every level. So it doesn't just have to be junior developers writing about their first experience with JavaScript, or senior developers talking about super advanced and deep technical concepts. Post about how you've been working with JavaScript for 5 years and you set up your first Express server the other day, or how you finally looked up exactly what that node nuint error actually means. So opening up the conversation about learning at all levels creates and defines the support structures for all our members, no matter where they are in our JavaScript journey. So let's recap. Socialization is all the things that we do to become members of a new community. And all the things that I've talked about today are used all the time in natural language learning and are really super effective at building language communities. They're all things that we can start using in our programming communities. So let's start thinking about the language that we're using when we interact with our fellow developers, when we're training new team members, when friends ask about JavaScript or start using it for the first time, and especially when we post on the internet about JavaScript. By thinking about the language that we use when we talk about JavaScript, each of us can make our community a friendlier, more comfortable, and more welcoming place for new people and new ideas. Thanks.